Good morning and welcome to Andrews United Methodist Church live stream. We're glad you joined us this morning. Just got a few announcements for you. First off, my name is Robbie Morris and I am the family minister here and also facilities coordinator. So welcome. We're just glad that you joined us this morning and we know that you'll be blessed by our service this morning. I just want to remind you that we're Facebook Live as we are now. And we're also on our YouTube channel, so go to Andrews United Methodist Church when you go on YouTube and you can watch the videos there. So just wanted to remind you this week, Good Friday service on Friday. We don't have a time yet, but we're going to send you out on Facebook and email an announcement about when to tune in for that because we're going to live stream that as well. We're continuing to do the welcome table. We're doing takeout. We need some folks to help with meal delivery on Thursdays at 5 o'clock. You can come a little bit earlier than that. If you're interested, please contact Tom Nash or the church office and let us know if you'd like to help out with that. We've had some great folks helping us out in the last few weeks. So, also, we have a few people that are helping out with, if you need help with grocery shopping or anything like that, contact the church office, or you can contact Donna Marie Brown, Mike Clements, or myself if you would need us to go pick up something for you. Also, Gabriel's meal was for today, suspended due to restrictions on our gatherings, of course, but we wanted to give you the opportunity, if you'd like to donate toward Gabriel's continuing medical care, you may bring or mail your donation to the church office, okay? So, just excited about being with you this morning, and God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Good to be with you in this strange, confusing. situation in which we find ourselves. Important to remember that there is no time or distance in the Spirit, so we are connected as we worship together. For those of you who have printed your bulletin down or perhaps are looking at it on another device, I invite you to join in the call to worship that's printed there. Awake to the day of triumph for our Savior. Give thanks for this day that leads to the cross. Come with your branches, hosannas and songs. Fill the air with welcome to the Lord. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Our opening hymn this morning you have printed as well. It's number 278 if you're going to use a hymnal. If you're going to use what's printed, it's Hosanna, Loud Hosanna. I invite you to sing and let your neighbors hear you if you're at home.
Kids, great to wish you were here with us this morning. I want you to imagine this morning, if you will. We're going to have a visit in Andrews from the president. Okay? That'd be pretty exciting, wouldn't it? Some people may be real excited, some people may not be. Okay? But anyway, we're going to have a parade. All right? That's the whole thing I want you to imagine is about a parade. So there's going to be a procession of people in this parade. There might be a band. Okay? That will lead the procession down Main Street here in Andrews. And there's going to be state representatives, the governor, senators, and our mayor. Lots of important folks are going to be in this procession, riding in So, got that in your head? All right, open your eyes, because we're going to be kind of acting this out. You do it at home, okay? So the band's coming down the street. Da, 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 da. We're waving flags. People are waving it from the cars. We're waving back, okay? So, and as it processes down the street, and there's people lined up all the way down the street, and then everybody passes by, and then it kind of dies down, and then everybody goes home. Okay, well, there's a similar situation that happened a long time ago, and we celebrate that today. It's called Palm Sunday. And Jesus, King Jesus, is coming into Jerusalem, and people are lined up and down the streets, and they're waving, instead of flags, they're waving palm branches. It is a huge celebration. But Jesus is not riding on a stallion, a white stallion horse, okay? He's a Cadillac. He's riding on a donkey. So very humbly, he's coming in to Jerusalem. So everybody's excited. Everybody's waving palm branches. And they're yelling out. They're saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." So today we celebrate Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. It was a day that marked the beginning of an incredible week, what we call Passion Week, which is what's coming up this week. A week that would see Jesus cheered in the beginning at this parade, then arrested, tried, convicted, and ultimately crucified. So it was a rough week for Jesus and for the disciples. But as the week came to an end, another week began, just as the previous one had begun, with a celebration. This time, celebrating his resurrection after his death. And that's what we'll be celebrating next week at Easter. So as we prepare our hearts for Easter, even though we are not together, our God is not confined by buildings. He's everywhere, and we can celebrate that and worship him anywhere. The scripture tells us that two or three are gathered together in his name. He's going to be there in the midst of us. So let me pray with you. Dear Jesus, our voices join with the voices of the people in Jerusalem some 2,000 years ago. Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. In Jesus' name.
Savior comes to us humbly, riding on a donkey and proclaiming a message of peace. As we gather, let us pray for the church. The church, not only our church here in America, but the church around the world, for the earth and for all its creatures. Pray for all people in need. Holy and gracious God, as we combine our voices and our faith together, we lift up these various concerns, these requests, these praises. We lift them before your throne of grace, knowing that even now you're attentive to them. Lord, we pray that Christians around the world would hear and share the word of God as true disciples. Pray, Lord, that all the ends of the earth would hear patience and hope, with the courage and wisdom to change whatever fails to be life-saving and life-giving. Those who see the cross starkly revealed in their lives, gracious God, let them draw strength from the name that is above every other name. Lord, we pray that we might live with gratitude for our ancestors, whose faith and witness have nourished our own, and all who mourn today, Lord, that they will be comforted, and that we who hope to greet Jesus when he comes again will be ready and filled with joy. God of mercy, hear our prayer. You are our Creator. You show your sons and daughters the way to freedom through the gentle obedience of your Son. Help us, gracious God, to put a sharp eye not only on this week, but certainly on this week, the gift of your love and grace displayed to us in the obedience of Jesus the Christ. Lord, we offer this prayer, the prayers of our hearts, as we offer ourselves to you in the name of the one who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us.
Lead us not into temptation.
Deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen.
Amen. As we come to our time of offering, I invite you to spend some time in prayer as you offer yourselves again in service to God and neighbor. May God bless that offering that you bring.
Thank you.
text this morning comes from Matthew's Gospel, the first 11 verses of chapter 21. It tells the story of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. Hear the words that Matthew has left for our consideration. When he approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus gave two disciples a task. He said to them, "Go into the village over there. As soon as you enter, you will find a donkey tied up and a colt with it. Untie them and bring them to me. If anybody says anything to you, say that the Lord needs it." And he sent them off right away. Now this happened to fulfill what the prophet said, "Say to daughter Zion, look, your king is coming to you, humble and riding on a donkey and on a colt, the donkey's offspring." The disciples went and did just as Jesus had ordered them. They brought the donkey and the colt, laid their clothes on them. Then he sat on them. Now a large crowd spread their clothes on the road. Others cut palm branches off the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds in front of him and behind him shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And when Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up. "Who is this?" they asked. The crowds answered, "It's the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." May God add God's blessings to this reading, this portion of Holy Scripture. Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, I ask that you open the eyes and ears of our understanding, that hearing a familiar story yet again, that we might hear something new. We ask, gracious God, that you take this time that we've come together to worship you. The music, the words that have been spoken, scripture text, that you use them all to mold us and shape us even more into the likeness of your Son, our Savior, Jesus. Now I pray, Lord, that the words of my mouth, along with the meditations of our hearts, they would be acceptable gifts to you, for you and you alone are our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Several years ago, a friend of Jean's invited us to go with her to see a Christmas parade. This friend went on and on about the unique nature of this particular Christmas parade. As she shared some of the details of parades past, she laughed a joyous and excited laughter. She emphasized the must-see nature of this parade as opposed to all others. So we said that we would go. I mean, we needed to see this, Robin said, must-see. It's going to be something new in our Christmas ritual. So we went. We drove quite a distance from our home to a rural community called Kent Square. We drove out into the country. It was beautiful country, but it was just that, country. Open fields, a house or barn along the way. Nothing really that would suggest a town or even a crossroads suitable for a parade. As we topped a ridge in the road on which we were driving, we, as far as you could see, were cars parked on the side of the road. Our friend said, "This is it, pull over, find a place to park." So we pulled off the road, precarious place, just off the pavement, half the car hanging into the ditch that made up the shoulder. And we got out of the car and we walked, and we walked, and we walked, until we came upon what was the starting line for the parade. People everywhere, essentially people, particularly out of the middle of nowhere. But we found a good place from which to watch the parade, and after just started roaring with applause. I'll write about the details of the parade for later publication. It's a hoot. What's interesting about parades is that they're a form of theater, street theater. They tell a story. A story of who we are, a story of what we deem to be important. This particular parade had all of the usual participants. There were fire engines and police cars. There were also tractors and large, heavy farm machinery, which, you know, that's part of the community that the parade was being conducted. There were homemade floats. And of course, in the case of Christmas parade, there was the honored guest, Santa Claus, at the end. The whole time the people were yelling. You could hear some of them saying things that you might hear in church. It was a strange gathering of folk. So I recall this particular event in our life, and reading it or recalling it as I was reading the text from Matthew on the parade that Jesus participated in, I'm reminded that parade that Jesus was a part of was at the beginning of another holy celebration. It was Passover in Jerusalem. That parade, just like the one that we had in Cat Square, told the story of a people and the coming fulfillment of a promise between them and their God. The story was a story of freedom and love and peace, told through the medium of street theater to counter a story of oppression and hatred. Two of my favorite theologians, John Dominic Crossan and the late Marcus Borg, wrote a book on the last week of Jesus' life entitled The Last Week, What the Gospels Really Teach Us About Jesus' Final Days in Jerusalem. And in that book, they promote a theory that on this particular day, two parades took place. From the east and from the Mount of Olives, as the scripture tells us, Jesus and his followers process into Jerusalem proclaiming the arrival of the kingdom of God, the arrival of justice and peace. From the west, Pontius Pilate and the Roman legion processing into Jerusalem, reinforcing a kingdom of domination and false peace. Convergence of two kingdoms representing two disparate ideologies. Now, Crossan and Borg based their theory on non-canonical sources, sources outside of the biblical witness. However, it makes perfect sense to me that these two parades would be happening at the beginning of Passover. Passover was a time when people came together. It was a celebratory time. And like a lot of celebrations, sometimes they get out of hand and the Romans would have no truck with that. So it makes perfect sense to me that given the conflict brewing, the message and the outcry are understood as somewhat treasonous. One commentator, Audrey West, I borrowed these words from her because they kind of set the stage for the treasonous aspect of this statement, or the shouts of Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. She writes, the triumphal entry into Jerusalem is to the crowds what Caesarea Philippi is to Peter. You remember that, Caesarea Philippi, where Peter confessed that Jesus is the Messiah. So these crowds are doing the same thing. Their shouts suggest that they recognize in Jesus the fulfillment of Jewish messianic expectations. Hosanna, they shout, literally saying, save us, son of David. But what were their expectations of Messiah? No doubt many in the crowd would recall the words of the prophets Isaiah and Zechariah. Tell the daughter of Zion, see your salvation comes. Humble and riding on a donkey and on a colt the foal of a donkey. What would these images elicit in the minds of the crowd? What does salvation mean to them? And does the fact that God's salvation is prefigured in the meek entrance of Jesus on a donkey instead of on a war horse affect the change of attitude as the week wears on? Were they expecting a warrior king to bring violent retribution to Israel's oppressors? Likely so, since the idea that Messiah would indeed bring retribution in like kind was the image that many in Israel recognized. So one wonders when the excitement and the fanfare of the parade has passed, one wonders if the jubilation of the parade turns to contempt as the message of God's salvation begins to settle in. If you're looking for some kind of violent response, and what you get is what most of us would consider a weak response, then the shine comes off of things, doesn't it? I think it brings this particular question, or as we think about how thoughts progressed over the week that leads to the cross, I think it brings a point for our consideration, excuse me, as to our ideas and image of the Savior. Excuse me. This story brings us to a place where we might consider our idea or image of the Savior. We might think again about our interpretation of the events of this week, of this day, but also this week. There's a cliche that many of us Christians, and maybe others who have a sense of God in some matter, that we tend to create God into the image that we wish God to resemble. And this creative notion on our parts distorts our ability to see and experience the true Messiah and the kingdom inaugurated in his birth, life, death, and resurrection. You see, the kingship that Jesus brings of forgiveness and reconciliation, of love and peace, of unity among all peoples, is a far cry from the warrior image of retribution desired then and sadly now. we enter this last stretch of our physical journey to the cross, perhaps we might think of our cries of Hosanna, save us. Are our cries inclusive? Do our cries for salvation seek unity and reconciliation for all people? Veronica Miles, another theologian, writes that the shout, save us, is a reminder that the stain of division still permeates the fabric of our existence, thwarting our ability to live in peace and threatening our collective well-being. She continues, almost instinctively, shouts of Hosanna escape from our lips, and we join this triumphal march, augmenting our litany commitment to self-examination, to reflection upon the quality of our lives together. For peace and reconciliation, she writes, become possible when common folk with uncommon courage oppose exclusionary practices and policies and together stand with the one who comes in the name of the Lord. This is the difference in the two parades, the parade of inclusion, the parade of forgiveness, of bringing unity among people as God dreamed in the beginning of things, over against a parade that suggests that some are more worthy than others, that power should be concentrated in the hands of a few who think they know what's best for all. The kingdom of God, the kingdom of freedom and love and peace and grace over against the kingdom of the world, oppression. The world and the nation in which we live reflect the power imbalance, reflect the disparity in wealth, disparity in influence which exists between those who have and those who have less or have not. The world in which we live, the nation in which we live, reflect the disparity of resources such as food and medicine, quality of health care, sustainable wages, proper shelter, clean air and water, just to name a few. The salvation for which the crowd is pleading, Hosanna, save us, the salvation for which the Christ came into the world and Jesus rode into Jerusalem, ultimately to the cross, is the message of the kingdom which Jesus taught throughout his life and ministry. And that is that we are responsible to offer loving care to one another as a response to God's gift of love for us, for all of humanity and creation. Today we shout, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Will we still be able to shout the same as we realize once again that our salvation is linked to the salvation of our brothers and sisters around the globe? And that our collective salvation requires the same sacrifice of love on our behalf. The same sacrifice of love that moved from this Palm Sunday to the cross, and then to the resurrection. Something to think about as we move through this week. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. response to the word, let us join together, affirming what we believe, praying together the Apostles' Creed. You have that in front of you on your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body,